Hello, I'm Jennifer Sedlock with Jennifer Speaks, and I want to welcome you to Celebrating Christ-Centered Holidays. You're about to hear a live presentation given for a women's program to help with getting organized early for the holidays and making sure you keep the most important aspects of the holidays front and center, no matter how busy you get. We'll talk about putting your plans, purpose, and priorities in focus to not get distracted by all the activities. So sit back and listen, but have your pen ready to capture all the great ideas that you want to keep.
And as she said, Susie introduced us. So Susie, you can wave at everyone. She's my friend. How many of you have girlfriends that you've had for a long time? Yeah. And we think about them more at the holidays, don't we? I want to ask you a couple of questions to get you started thinking. If you could experience the holidays the best that you've ever had, what would that look like to you this year? How can you keep Christ centered in all the busyness that you're about to go through? How can you keep him at the center, and especially in Christmas? And how can you prepare, and what can you do to make this holiday season more joyful, more peaceful than it's ever been before? Now, if you're drawing a blank on any of those questions, don't worry, because we're going to spend the next 45 minutes making your plan, looking at what do you want it to be. And we're going to put some of that on paper, and we're going to brainstorm a little bit, and I'm going to take you through this. So we're going to have some fun together as well. And I want you to just sit back, relax, eat your dessert, but in a few minutes I'm going to ask you to pick up a pen. So, all right. You know, before I get started, I'm just a mom, you know. I run the carpool, I am making lunches every day, breaking up fights. I've got a 10-year-old, a 7-year-old, and a 3-year-old. You probably saw them on the picture, maybe it was 2 years old. See, I can't even update the picture for you. I'm so busy. I'm running around doing the same things that many of you are doing now or you might do in the future. We're all busy and we're all at different ages and stages of our lives. And at every stage, there is trials, there are joys, there are choices and sacrifices at every stage. So I'm going through the same things as you are and some different. And we're going to touch on how can we really focus on where we're at and what we want to do for the holidays, even through that craziness that we might be going through. And one of the things I want you to look at is how we're going to prepare not only our hearts, but our minds and our homes, all of them. Because, you know, I love the holidays, but I always think of my girlfriend Colette. She always calls it holidays, D-A-Z-E, because it's just a days. We're resting here, we're resting there. What are we doing? Why does she say that? Okay, let's see, we're shopping, and then there's the cookie party we got to go to, oh, and then there's that party, and I got to go get a dress for that party at the husband's office, or maybe you have one at your office too, and maybe there's the party at school, and did I mention shopping? And then there's the cooking we got to bake, oh, and we got to decorate. Oh, that means I got to shop some more for the decorations, and then we've got to run here and do another errand, and then, you know, I started to think about this. It's women that run the holidays, isn't it? You know, would there be holidays without us? I'm not quite sure they would happen. I was even talking to one of the guys, and he said, yeah, I don't need that wrapping paper. Why you got to put wrapping paper on it? Just buy it. Stick it under the tree. We're going to be shopping. We're going to be doing all this, getting everything prepared. Not to mention standing in line at the post office. Did I tell you that one? We've got all these things, errands here, there, and everywhere. How can we make it less crazy? How can we do what we plan what we do, and have it be a little bit more how we want it, peaceful? You know, I think of it like I'm a runner. So I think many of you think of the holidays as a sprint. You know, I ran cross country and did some of the long distance, and I also ran track, and I ran the shorter distance, one time around the track for a 400 or two times for an 800. And if we think of the holidays as a sprint, it can be really crazy. You know, just think about it. Let me remind you, in 2 weeks, we have Halloween. In 6 weeks, we have Thanksgiving. And in 9.5 weeks, we have Christmas. Is that a surprise to any of you? Now, I know all of you have calendars. If you didn't know that, then you're either in denial, you're trying to hide from it. But we have 9.5 weeks until Christmas. So, and I think some of you are going to start to think you're sprinting. And it's like, oh, we're going to run to this and run to that and run to that. And I want to encourage you to think of it more like a longer race or a marathon. Because who watched the Summer Olympics? Did you watch any of the track? Any of you see the Lightning Bolt? Remember, he won the 100 and the 200. And he seemed to have more energy to spare. He's like going like this and smiling at people. And it's like, he seemed to have extra energy. But did you watch any of the other people? They were like flat on their stomachs and falling down and exhausted. And they don't even run it for 10 seconds, maybe 20. We got weeks to go. We got to think of this more like a marathon. And I'll tell you the benefit of that. When you're in a marathon or when you're in a longer race, you got time to look around. You got time to check out. Am I on course? Am I where I want to be? If you're running a longer race and you're thinking about the holidays where you have plenty of time, everything's okay, everything's good, you can make a plan, and then if you're a little off course, get back on course. That's the beauty of it. So I'm going to use an analogy. When I was in high school and I would go to, we'd go to some remote location to run a cross-country race. And I'm going to talk about 3 points today. Vision, plan, and action. Because I'm going to suggest if you don't have all three, you're not going to get to your goal. It's not going to happen. Because you have to have all three. When we would go and I wouldn't know the course. So we would check out the course, and I'd jog along and see, oh, we got to go up this hill and go around this tree and maybe around a lake. So I'd have a picture of what it was going to be like. Have you thought about your next 9.5 weeks? What does it look like? What do you want it to look like? Have you thought about the vision of that, the picture, picture each holiday? What do you want it to be like? The second one is a plan, and if you don't have a plan, you might be off target of what you want for that vision. So I would make a plan. Oh, within the first mile, I want to be in the top 50, because you start one of these races with like 100 girls. So I want to be in the top 50. And by mile 2, I'd want to be in the top 20. And by mile 3, I'd want to be in the top 10. Didn't always make it, but you have to have a plan. And sometimes I would plant my parents in locations I thought I'd be exhausted, and they're just there yelling and supporting me. Would really help me. Do you have some kind of plan during your holidays? Plan now for coffee with a friend on X day to help you slow down. Something that's going to help you, or maybe make a shopping date with someone, or whatever will help in your plan keep you on track. Make a date with yourself to review your plan. And then action is the third one, and we have to take action, or we'll never get there, okay? Because I got the vision of where the track was, and then I have the plan, but when that gun goes off, it's me just stepping and taking each step. So we're going to go through that. Pull out your piece of paper. It should be in the center, or maybe you've already passed it out if you haven't. Pass that around. We're going to talk about vision. What would you do if you knew you wouldn't fail? This works for anything, any goal or dream you have. We're going to focus on the holidays for this one. What would you do if you knew you wouldn't fail this holiday season? Would you do anything differently? We're going to begin with the end in mind, something I learned from Stephen Covey. So picturing the end results you want can help you with how to get there. Now, I know some of you, you think about holidays and you think, I'm going to be seeing my family. Is that traumatic for any of you? I know some of you, it's just a joy. But some of you out there, it's like, it's going to be an endurance test. So I have one suggestion for that. Read James chapters 1 through 5 as often as you need to. maybe every morning when you're there or when they're there. But if you have any family challenges, I'm also well aware that some of you may be going through something really traumatic. The holidays are a tough time. Economic times, challenging like we have, are a tough time for a lot. Because when something's already weak, it starts to crack faster when there's pressure. I'm in a small group study with about 50 women, and we break into smaller groups. Two of the women, their husbands have left in the last 3 weeks. And we're talking about Christian families. So I know there's a lot of tough stuff going out there. And if you barely scraped yourself in here today, I want you to be encouraged that you're supposed to be here. All of us are supposed to be here. We're here for a reason. Because you've been called to be here to make the holidays more joyful through all circumstances, more peaceful, because somebody needs your strength. You might be here for yourself, but you're also here for somebody else. So think about that as you go through the day as well. Okay, I'm going to ask you a few questions, and as I'm asking you, I want you to write them down. You're going to share with a friend in a minute, so you have to write something to think about it. Just think about, how do you want your holidays? This is that vision time. You're picturing it. So I'm just going to ask a few questions. And you write down either answers to that, or you can ignore me and write your own vision of what you want for the holidays. What event will you probably be asked to go to? Got to factor those in. Which ones do you really want to go to? What is something you do that's special to your family? Maybe some traditions that you want to keep up? Jot those in there. I know you have a lot of space there, right? What is something you don't want to do this year? What's something you could say no to? What could you do to create a more spiritual foundation to each holiday? I'll give you some ideas in a minute if you're coming up blank. What is your wildest dream for some holiday in the future? Maybe not this year. If money was no object, someone was going to pay for it, what would you do? Would you go on a cruise for Christmas? Would you just run away by yourself with your significant other? What would you do? If you could do anything, spend as much money as you wanted of someone else's. What do you think God wants you to do this holiday season? If you don't know, you can always ask. The minute Amy asked me to talk on this topic, I thought of a great book. If you've never read this book, you might want to jot this down. Power of a Positive Mom. If you're not a mom, there's Power of a Positive Wife. Carol Ladd is the author. She's got some great ideas. If you're coming up short and not sure how to answer some of the questions I just asked you, I'm going to give you some ideas. And you might want to write them all down, because even though you might start thinking, oh, I can't do that, or I can't afford the time or the money or this, you might be able to next year. And you might lose the idea. Unless you get the book, of course, then you have the ideas. But she comes up with a lot of great ones, and it's all about making marvelous memories. And she goes through every holiday. I'm just going to share two with you, Thanksgiving and Christmas. How about if you, for Thanksgiving, allow each child to pick one favorite recipe and you help them cook it if they're too young, or have them, you can do this with anybody, obviously, and everybody bring one favorite recipe. Decorate the dinner table together. Go out and pick some stuff out of the yard. Go to Costco, Michael's, whatever. How about make a gratitude poster? Right, I am thankful for, and leave it up in the house for a few weeks before Thanksgiving, and then read what everybody wrote on it at the Thanksgiving dinner table. Or how about creating a tablecloth that everybody writes on at the dinner, and then you can bring it out the next year. How about read the story of the first Thanksgiving or the Thanksgiving Proclamation by George Washington or Abraham Lincoln? Or the last one, how about setting out 5 kernels of corn in remembrance of the pilgrims that made it through a harsh winter, that God helped them through, and they had some days 5 kernels of corn to eat, and that was it. Let's move to Christmas. Helping a family in need, maybe picking a specific family, maybe inviting them over or getting them gifts, praying with them. How about read Christmas traditions from the land of your heritage? Decorate the house and the Christmas tree together. Many of us do that. Set out a small box with thin strips of paper, and whenever anybody catches somebody else doing something kind, write it down. That's great for probably people with teenagers. I'm just glad to be out of diapers and before teenagers. Anybody get that? Okay. Set aside one day for baking. Drive around and look at Christmas lights on the houses together. Invite a family over for tamales and chili. Give your kids Christmas pajamas on Christmas Eve, or yourself if you don't have kids. I read that the other day. See, I get the blessing of preparing this lesson, so I learn more of it than you do. I started my Christmas shopping earlier this year by writing this, and I bought myself pajamas the other day because I had read that, and I was like, hey, I like these. I'm going to get them and give them to my husband to give to me. Christmas Eve. Why not? Get what I want. Give only 3 gifts to your children, as Christ received 3 gifts at his birth. That would be a challenge for some of you, huh? And how about read the Christmas story of Luke 2? This is so cute. My little son made this. It says, "Dear Mom, I love my mom because my mom is nice." N-I-S-E. You got to keep these things. So cute. He's 10 now, and he's sassy now. Okay, so those are some ideas. Thanksgiving, Christmas. I want you to share right now with a neighbor what's one idea. Can be an old one, can be a new one, but share just real quick. Hopefully everybody has something written in there. Some new ideas maybe. I saw some people have turned to the back and writing on the back. Lots of new ideas. Now, we start at the vision stage, and we have all these great ideas. How many of you have had these great ideas that 2 years later you think, wow, I never did that. Why did I never do that? I don't even remember. You remember something? I encourage you to make a dream list. All the things you want to be, do, and have. You might even want to write that down. What do you want to be? What do you want to do? And what do you want to have still? I know you still want things because you would be 6 feet under if you did. What do you want to be? What do you want to do? What do you want to have? There's still things in life you want to experience. So that's your dream list. And you have all these things that you want, maybe. Now, I have some things in life that have helped me along the way to figure out more about what I like and want. How many of you have heard of the Myers-Briggs Type Indicator? Okay, many of you have. This is a personality style indicator. And basically, it's been around since the 40s. A couple of women started it when all the men went to the war, and the women were trying to figure out who wants to do what job. And they started to see patterns that women were interested in certain things. And then we took it to men, and, you know, it's the most heavily researched instrument, and so, therefore, the most accurate. And I stumbled across it probably 15, 16 years ago and found that it really answered and solved a lot of things that were confusing to me. It really helped me decide how to carve out a path in my career that fit my personality. That I was going to school and focusing on things that were influences from my dad or maybe bosses. And so I started to realize that I wanted to pick a mate based on personality styles, and now raising children, understanding these styles makes it so much easier. And with our coworkers or with other people, you know, they're really not out there to irritate you. They're just being themselves, I promise you. And that happens to irritate you, but They're just being themselves and doing things the way they prefer. And I want to bring up a couple of volunteers. Maybe the first one, somebody who knows you're an extrovert, that you just get so much energy from people and doing things with people. You're a high energy person. You know that you're an extrovert. Are there some of you out there? It's getting dark out here. You want to come on up? Yeah, come on. Okay. And now, let's bring up someone who knows you're an introvert. And introverts tend to lose energy with people. They tend to need to go away. They're very social. You would never know. But they go away to be by themselves to recharge. Who out there knows? What's that? And they don't want to come up here. But I need one. You're absolutely right. She's on to it. She knows. The extroverts, they'll all run up. Oh, what are you going to ask me? I'll do it, whatever. The introverts are like, okay, if I have to. See, nobody's raising their hand. Do I have one? Okay. Thank you so much. Come on up. They're social introverts. Okay. We can go over by her if you want. Okay. So I'm going to ask them a question. And they're going to answer very differently. And, you know, I already know this about them because of what they've stated they think they are. And introverts tend to like a heads up. They like to think and process things a lot longer. So you get to go second. Okay? I know you prefer that. The extrovert, they don't care. They'll answer right away. And then sometimes they talk and then they think and then they change their mind. So we might give you a second chance. Okay. So the question is this. How do you want to spend your holidays? On that question I asked, if you could do anything, what would you do? Somebody else is paying, what would you do?
Actually, I just wanted to be at home with friends and family.
How many friends and family approximately would you say?
Well, my favorite holiday event is my aunt's annual
birthday
party.
From?
And
no.
There's you.
We need a microphone. Hold on.
My favorite Christmas event is my aunt's cookie night party, and I think this year is the 36th annual, and there's usually over 100 people decorating cookies that night, and it's great because the people I see once a year, and I can't wait to see them all.
And do you stay late? You're like one of the last people to leave.
One of the last people out.
Oh, yeah.
Last one.
See, you can always trust an extrovert. They're going to stay till that party is over. Okay. Barring other emergencies and husbands that drag you home and things like that. Okay, great. All right, hey. Okay, now, same question. You can do anything, go anywhere. What would you want to do?
Well, I want to be ready for Christmas early ahead of time.
Okay.
Maybe have a little overnight with my husband and just kind of settle into the rush that's going to come, go to Christmas Eve service with my family, get up, make Christmas breakfast, go to my mom's with the family for dinner.
Now, when you say go to service with your family, how many are you talking about?
Well, who would go over there? Probably be about 10.
About 10, okay.
And for breakfast, it'd probably only be about 16.
Okay.
For dinner, probably 20 to 22.
And then what do you want to do the next day?
The next day, usually for skiing. That's kind of hectic, but we have more family time all week.
All right.
Nine of us packed in a
Is that exhausting for you?
Yes. Actually, when we go up skiing, Lance and I usually have a hotel room for about one night so we can just kind of escape the crowd.
Okay. All right. Do you see a little bit of difference there? Okay. I want to thank you with something. The book, Conversations on Faith.
Oh,
so
thank you very much.
Each of
thank
you get,
you.
And you want to take that back for her. Thank you so much for coming up. So for about 12 years now, I've been doing programs on Myers-Briggs, and we go through all the areas of preference, and I pull people up, and sometimes in the smaller groups of 20 or 50, we all of us do the activities, and you know what? We just are who we are, and we're born with this. They have done nature versus nurture and all kinds of tests and all kinds of validity and reliability tests. I even did my master's thesis on the team report and how entire teams, and if you think about it, entire companies have personalities, and they tend to be like the top people in the company. Because, and so you look at companies like IBM that are, you know, a little more methodical about how they do things, and you see these fly-by-the-seat-of-the-pants kinds of companies, and it's all due to who's leading and what their type is, and so, and how much risk-taking they want to take. Why am I bringing this up now? Because I think our personality has to do with how we want to plan our holidays. I think it's really important to look at how much can you do, and your spouse. You know, I'd be at every party there was. My husband's like, oh, we got to leave. And I'm like, we've been here a half hour. You know, so I can't bring him to the ones I want to stay late to. We have to look at our personalities, and it makes us work together very well because we understand these things. So when it's really important to me to bring him along, I do, and he understands that, and we have this conversation about it. And when it's really important to me to be with my girlfriends and hang out for a long time, then I just don't choose to bring him. And he's fine with that. He wants to be invited, but he's just happy as punch to stay home and not go. So knowing this about each other, we work together a lot better in all kinds of things. So in looking at Myers-Briggs types, I think it's a great way to look at what are our natural abilities. But this leads us into thinking about what are our spiritual gifts as well. Because we grow those natural abilities, and I think they're God-given as well. But when we receive Christ, the Holy Spirit gives us spiritual gifts. Now, whether we're not mature in them yet, and so we don't even know what they are, until at some point we stumble upon, either in the Bible where it tells us that we have them, or somebody shares that with us, a lot of churches are now teaching it and helping people to understand why we have them and what we're supposed to do with them. So I wanted to share a couple things with, well, why would you even care? Well, number one, it is, we are actually commanded to figure out what they are. And that's in 1 Corinthians. Because if you think about it, you may have heard this, we're all a part of the body of Christ. And someone's an arm, and someone's a leg, and someone's a knee. And if someone isn't serving in their gifting, we're missing something. There's something, there's a hole there in the body. And so it's really our job to figure out what they are. And another reason that we would want to is because it's an incredible blessing. You wouldn't believe what a blessing it is if you've never figured out what yours are. You know, we're told in Revelations that we're going to get rewards in heaven for service and for doing, you know, going into figuring out what those are and living out our life purpose. However, you know, it has nothing to do with salvation, but it's more reward. But there's more blessings right here and now that are incredible. For example, and how would you find those out? Let's say you're going to ask that. There are lots of ways, but one way is just Google spiritual gifts, and you'll find all kinds of tests on it. You take those tests. I'd say take 3 or 4 or 5 and compare the results. And what you'll find is that you come up with 2 real strong top spiritual gifts, about 5 or 6 or 7 that you'll operate in a lot, that God will call you to operate in those. He can give you any of them at any time to do His will. Some of them, preaching, teaching, you might not be given, but you might be given it at a specific time for a specific reason. But your top 2 is where you're going to be called for service the most, and those top 5. And again, it's as we mature in them as well. So I'll give you some examples. For those of you that this is new and you're not even sure, what is she talking about? But in 1 Corinthians, if you read in there, it talks, it shares, there's about, and this is discrepancy, but there's about 24 to 27 spiritual gifts. It depends on who you're looking at defining it. And some churches do not recognize a couple of them. But if you're looking at which churches to look for, there's a couple I'd recommend, Willow Creek and Saddleback. And here's one reason. Saddleback's in Los Angeles. You may know Rick Warren, the pastor, from Purpose Driven Life, the book he wrote. That church does a lot of training on spiritual gifts. And actually the class is called SHAPE. So let me tell you what SHAPE means, and it's actually on your handout too. It's not just the spiritual gifts. It's the heart, abilities, personality, and they use Myers-Briggs, and your experiences. So you can have the exact same spiritual gift as someone else, but your service may be in a completely different area. An example of that would be, let's say you have the gift of teaching, and maybe you've been through a divorce. So your teaching may be in a recovery program to help women or men that are going through that. If you're, say another person has a gift of teaching, and let's say they either have small children or that's just their area that they love. Maybe they're preschool teachers and they serve in your children's programs at church. Another area might be with women. I have a gift of teaching, but it's not one of my strongest. I have stronger gifts, but I love being with women, especially. I help out in Awana, I teach in Awana, I do stuff with kids all the time, but it's not my true passion, but I have young children, and it's my calling at this time, and I'm happy to do it, and I think, sometimes I walk away and I think, why did they ask me to do that? I must have botched it up, and someone said, oh, no, that was great, kids loved it, you know, and I'm in Target, and they're like, hi, Miss Jennifer, I'm like, who is that? So, where your heart is, where your abilities are, where your personality is, and where your experiences are, all help fuel where are those spiritual gifts, where you might want to be serving. And so take a look at that at some point, if it's something you haven't looked at. There are some things online as well. I've got a program on that that you can click on my website, and you can just, for an outline and to take a look at some information on it. But really, you Google it and you'll find so much information. I call that program, if you're looking for it, Discovering Your Spiritual Gifts. So, and it's on the Faith page. Pretty easy to find. Okay, so we've taken a look at a couple of things. We've looked at this vision, and if we look at where our personality is and where our gifting is and where we want to be for the holidays, that's all kind of a big picture. Now we have to move to a plan. And what's the difference between a dream and a goal? Does anybody know? A plan, that's it, you're listening. A plan, that's the only difference. You've got a dream, it's way too big. You pluck it off your dream list and you create that plan, now you have a goal. That's the only difference. So now that you have this goal, how are you going to actually break it down into action steps will be the next part. But let's take that plan. Let's say our plan is we want to center Christ in our holidays. So there's one question you have to ask for any plan. And if you're familiar with mind mapping, you basically put the goal in the middle of the page and you start writing lines and you just write all the ideas you can think of. And you're just asking yourself this one question. This will work for any goal, by the way. Any goal. You just start asking, what do I need to do to achieve this goal? What do I need to do to achieve this goal? You might want to write that one down. What do I need to do to achieve this? What are all the things I need to do? You can sit around a group and brainstorm this. I teach this to CEOs. I teach this to moms. I teach this to anybody who's trying to get to a goal. What are all the things you need to do to get there? So you tell me, what do you need to do to get there to have Christ be more of a center of your Christmas? Anybody? What's that?
Read the Bible.
What else? Just yell them out.
Pray as a family.
Pray as a family. Okay, what else? Delegate some things. What else? You could maybe research something on the internet to look something up. You could get that book I said. What was that?
Do less.
Do less. Say no. Just say no. I've got a girlfriend, her whole career is on teaching women how to say no. She gets paid lots of money, and she travels all around. All she does is teach people how to say no. Because we don't know how. We need to keep learning that. Sometimes we have to learn it over and over. What else? What could we do to have Christ more center of our holiday? Maybe serve, maybe care about other people's needs. Get the focus off ourselves sometimes. Absolutely. All kinds of things that we can do to have more Christ-centered holidays. You could read some things in a magazine. There is stuff everywhere. If you just set that as your goal and you start doing some ideas, call a couple girlfriends and ask them, what do you think about this? What would you do to reach that goal? You will come up with so many amazing ideas. If we had another half hour, we'd sit down and mind map this, and we'd share it, and we'd come up with so many ideas. That's what I do in my seminars when I'm doing Running Toward Your Dream, and we're doing vision, plan, action. In the plan, we sit down and mind map. I mind mapped getting married 12 years ago. That was like 10 pages thick, and I had a million things. What are all the things you need to do to have a successful marriage? I mean, wedding, excuse me. Those are totally different, but that'd be a lot of pages. Okay, so to have a, you need a videographer, you need a photographer. Why am I not saying do a linear list? Because it stops us. It stops us in our brain because we want to analyze it, because we're in our left brain and we're trying to analyze, oh, I don't know if I can do that. Get that out of there when you're dreaming and when you're making a plan of what are all the things I need to do. Because you can cross stuff off later, you can analyze it later, you can mix it later, but not right now, not when you're trying to think of all the ideas of how to get there. So it works with any goal. Okay, so now that we have a plan, think about some things and put them in your planning section of how can you actually do some of the things that you put in your vision. You might want to focus on one or two and create one of those mind maps and ask yourself, how could you do it? Because if you don't break it down to the task level, it's likely that you're going to put it off and not get to it and not do it. And we're gonna break one down in a little bit. How many of you have ever prayed for peace or patience? Lord, I want patience now. I need it yesterday. I think about it every time I'm yelling at my kids. Because we get impatient, don't we? I'm going to suggest that maybe we're not supposed to be praying for peace and patience. Because these are, do you remember what they are? Fruit of the Spirit. And fruit of the Spirit is the result. It is the result of the Spirit in us. And that's referring to the Holy Spirit. So I would suggest if you are praying for patience in the next 9.5 weeks, pray for the Holy Spirit to come in you. Pray to understand what God wants you to do today. And go to the Bible and look at what the answers are that day. Even if you can only understand 10% of what you just read, you can apply some of that to your life. And I think when we try to pray for all these things that we have no control over. I have no control over patience when my 3-year-old is not going out the door and I need to, and she wants to play something else. And, you know, we get to these places where we can't do it on our own. We have to have the Holy Spirit to take over, to give us those fruits. And the fruit, it's not plural, it's fruit of the Spirit. You find them in Galatians. And what are they? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, faithfulness, self-control. I forgot one. Goodness. I don't know about you, but when I think about gentleness, I'm not always gentle with my kids. And when we get to those places where we're not, and we know, it's because we're walking closer. The closer you walk with Christ, the more that mirror reminds us how far we are and what we specifically need to do. So we do have to look. In fact, I'm doing this study with Beth Moore in Exodus, and the basins that they created when they did the old offerings, they would make these basins out of gold, and it was actually broken mirrors, and the priest had to wash, and these were Aaron and his disciples, they had to wash and look in that mirror, and there's significance there, but we have to look in the mirror to see when we're not being the fruit of the Spirit and when we're and why we're not. Because I don't think we can do it on our own. Not consistently. Not for a long time. When I look at the long term of a faith walk, you know, we grow and our faith is built over time. When I was asked to be in this book and I looked at Dr. Robert Schuller, I think you know who he is. Dave Dubecki broke his arm. He's the baseball player that got cancer in his arm. And Jillian. I was like, okay, why am I being asked to be in this? Could you explain to me again? And 14 others. I had no idea that of why I was going to be in that. because I have been, and this is the thing, I have been praying for 3 years to figure out how to incorporate God into my work. I could give up my kids. I could give up my husband. I could see how they were gifts. But I couldn't figure out how to mix work. And then I'm asked to be in this book, and I'm thinking, this has nothing to do with what I do. Why? It was clear as mud. And then, a couple years later, I had been asking my husband for 4 years, can we have a third child? Because I had two boys. I have always wanted a girl. I cried when it was that first boy. And I cried at that second boy. And I love my boys, don't get me wrong. And they laugh at this story. But I wanted my girl. And my husband said the final no after 4 years. I was so defeated. I was like, okay. And I had 7 years of baby stuff that I needed to get rid of, so I started getting ready for a garage sale. And all of a sudden, I started thinking, my jeans are a little tight. And I was pregnant. And I'm telling you, there's really no earthly way I was pregnant at this point. I don't know how it happened. It had to be a gift. Well, okay. But it shouldn't have happened. It was not the right timing, is my whole point. And I was taking some things. So this really was a gift, and I knew it was. But I struggled for the next 4 months, because I was like, God, you better give me a girl. You would not deep-seed this need in me and this desire if you weren't going to give it to me, were you? I was fighting with the Lord over the whole thing. And 2 weeks before we were going to go find out if it was a boy or girl, I had to give it over. I finally said, you know what, your plans for my life are so much better than mine. If it's a boy, I'm going to love that little boy, and I'm going to know that it's your plan for me. But I had to release it. And 2 weeks later, my two sons and my husband and I walk into the room, and the technician tells us, it's a girl. And my husband, who's the skeptic, says, are you sure? And my firstborn, who knows how much I want a girl, jumps up and grabs me. And the second boy, he is mad as a hornet because he wanted a boy to pound on like he's been pounded on. He still laughs about that. And my husband said, well, what do you want to name her? And I pull up my sleeve with the wristband that says Faith on it because I knew he wouldn't like the name. And he had to say yes after all that we've been through. And her middle name is Jillian. And Jillian. I don't know. There's all kinds of things that weave into our faith walk. I never planned to be the commander of Awana. In fact, I had a one-year-old. I was still postpartum. My doctor said, you can't be postpartum a whole year later. I said, yes, I can! I was still nursing. I still think when you're nursing, you should not be serving. Let me tell you, I tell the women all the time, just give it a few months. You can just stay home. We're given a beautiful gift of a child. We should spend some time with them. That's just my view. But that whole thing is amazing, too. That whole story of how that happened, essentially in a nutshell, I called to sign up my kids. And I'd been praying for like 3 weeks, where should I serve again? And I called to sign up my kids, and she says, oh, we're canceling Awana. I said, you're canceling Awana? We've had it for 4 years. How can you do that? All these families are going to be in an uproar. What are you talking about? Can't find a commander. Oh, dumb question. What does the commander do? That's me, right? And she starts to lay out what the commander does, and it's what I'd been visualizing in my quiet time for the last week. I was like, oh, I think maybe I'm your next commander. And over the course of the next 6 months, I started to see why it was perfect for me. My two top gifts are leadership and administration. It's a lot of administration, and I had 75 volunteers to lead. I've been a manager for 10 years. I didn't put it all together, but God sure did. And now I'm a director. I took one step down this year, finally. I want a lot less responsibility. Please. So, I don't think I'll be doing Awana forever. But it's just right for me, right now. And I would have never picked it, but yet I was called to do it. So those are just some areas where, if you haven't searched out your spiritual gifts, you should. Because as you look for it and ask the questions, they'll be answered. And you'll start to hear those taps on the shoulder, or those whispers in your ear, or that maybe you should do that. You'll start to hear it if you listen.
in taking the action, our third point, we're going to wrap up here, it's really simple. You break it down into the action steps from the plan. It's the same thing. You take your anything that isn't a to-do, you can break it down further. What do I need to do to achieve this? What do I need to do? So you break it down even further. I brought two other things for you because they're what we're talking about today. I've got a program on here. It's an hour-long Myers-Briggs, and by the end of the program, you would know your type. It goes through the four areas of preference. And so I brought that, and I also brought Running Toward Your Dream, which is a program. It's not about the holidays, but it's about vision, plan, action. Has a lot more details, and you can listen to it in your car while you're running towards your shopping. I put these three in a package for you today for $40. They're normally $70 if you bought each individually. And I've also got books out there. They're normally $19.95 in the stores, but they're only $10 today. So those are three pieces I brought you to support what we're talking about today if you want to take it a step further. Or I've gave you some ideas on Googling and really taking those action steps are taking it from that plan to what do I want to do next. Now, we've talked about a lot of things, and so I don't want you to think, oh my gosh, I've only got 9.5 weeks to Christmas, and now she's talking about spiritual gifts. We'll put that on January. It's okay. It's no big deal. Put it on next year. Where are you now? Where is God meeting you today is what you need to focus on. So I hope that in just talking about this today, it's really gotten you thinking about, what do I want for the holidays? What are the things that are important to me? But I want to take it one step further, and somebody led right into it so nicely. And I think we should look at other people. And we should look at what's something we can do. I'd like to challenge you over the next 9.5 weeks to wake up every day and say, who could I give some love to today? Who needs a little bit of Christ's love in their life? Or pray, God, use me today. How can I serve somebody today? If we get the focus off of ourselves, I'm telling you, it's going to be more peaceful. It's going to be more joyful. It solves those first three questions we talked about. How to create a more Christ-centered holiday. If you're focused on doing something for someone else, you will be. Because as you search, if you're reading in the Bible, if you don't know where to read, I've got a suggestion. Go to enewhope.org. They've got life journals. And what a life journal does, just $6, it's written by Wayne Cordiero. He's the one who created it. He's the pastor of a huge megachurch in Oahu. And he created these life journals. And basically, you read a little bit of scripture, you pick one verse, and you write about it. So, scripture, observation, application, and prayer. And by writing, I'm telling you, have you ever tried to read through the Bible in a year? It doesn't happen, does it? Forget it. By the time you get to Leviticus, you're sleeping, and Deuteronomy, you don't know what's going on. Well, if you do this life journal, you're applying it to your life. And it's easy to read through the Bible in a year. That's the first time I read through the Bible in a year was when I started that life journal, enewhope.org. They're also on a link on my links page. And I suggest that because if you don't have a Bible study and you aren't in a women's group or some kind of study, then maybe start there. But if you start to ask the questions, the answers will be there. If you start to ask, who can I serve today? What can I do just in the next 9.5 weeks? You'll be amazed and blessed by the answers. It's like when Jesus was washing the feet of the disciples. And Peter was like, no, no, don't wash my feet. He said, yes, I need to. And in John 13:14, he talks about, I did this because I'm asking you to go out and do that. And in John 13:34-35, the new commandment was love one another. So if we can just focus on that, that is what's going to happen to our holidays. I hope that we've shared some new ideas with you and that over the next few weeks, you'll be thinking about where you are on your journey. And if you've never invited Christ into your life, I encourage you to ask maybe the friend you came with, Or just go straight to the Bible and ask, what is this? Or just pray, God, reveal yourself to me. I don't get this. I don't understand this. Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for this time. Thank you for these women and the wonderful, peaceful day that you've given us and the great seminars today where we learned all kinds of fun things for the holidays. Really got us thinking and got us set up for how to prepare the holidays. Maybe some gifts to make for other people and things that we can do. Lord, let us be your servants. Let us go out and give love to others. And look at all the servants here today. We thank you for the people who served us food, who guided us to sessions. Lord, they are your servants. We are. Lord, thank you. And may we go in peace for the next few weeks and look to you in your son's name. Amen.
I hope you enjoyed that talk, and I hope you wrote down a few great ideas. Now, pick three to make sure that you implement, write those down, prioritize them 1, 2, 3, and you're set to go. Have a great day, and please visit the website for any other information, jenniferspeaks.com.